Hello friends, in this lecture we focus on carbohydrates by discussing the chemistry of carbohydrates in terms of structure and function, and then we continue with the monosaccharides, disaccharides and polysaccharides of importance to biological systems. So this lecture is dedicated onto carbohydrates. So carbohydrates are basically produced by photosynthesis. And if you remember your basic chemistry from high school, you know that photosynthesis is a process whereby plants use carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, water from the soil, as well as sunlight energy to convert carbons into carbohydrates. And natural carbohydrate sources as found in grains and cereals, those found in fruits, and honey are very important source of energy for animals. Carbohydrates can include simple sugars, with the basic formula being CH2O, where N can vary, especially for monosaccharides, it can vary from 3 to 7, as well as long polymers such as starch, which can have varieties of sizes and shapes. But the simplest sugar, which is glucose, it's known to be the primary source of energy for the brain and nervous system, and it can also be used by many other tissues. Bear in mind that when 1 gram of carbohydrate is burned, it releases approximately 4 kilocalories of energy, and the healthy diet, as we have it, must contain a mixture of both complex as well as simple sugars like glucose, fructose, and sucrose. So bear in mind, particularly during breakfast, you cannot say that you are taking only sugars for breakfast, no. And that is why our morning breakfast, usually if you are taking a beverage, it comes with bread, which contains starch, and which being a form of a complex carbohydrate. It's been established that if you have a diet that is only found in simple sugars, it's one of the causes of tooth decay and promote obesity and even diabetes. However, data has shown that some complex carbohydrates, because upon their digestion, they release high amounts of glucose, they can also influence some of these things. And also bear in mind that the nature of your job, particularly a person who does much more complex, what do you call it, hard labor, may prefer to go for complex carbohydrates. Why? Because they release their energy steadily and it can last them a longer time. Again, complex carbohydrates are also better than simple ones. Why? Because they release the energy over a prolonged period of time, like I've mentioned. And in addition, if you take a complex carbohydrate like cellulose, it acts as dietary fiber and improves the movement of bowels, as you may know. And it's also been demonstrated in research that complex dietary fiber has also been known to help in the clearance of glucose from the bloodstream. It is also very hard to determine the exact percentage of a diet that should be carbohydrates, because this is very dependent on the physical activity of the person. So if you are involved in more physical activity, more strenuous activity, then you may require even up to 65%. But if you are doing something less, then it could just be reduced to not more than 10%. So we talk about the first class of carbohydrates, which we call the monosaccharides. So the word mono means single, and saccharide is a general classification for carbohydrate. So monosaccharide means that they have only one sugar unit, and a good example is glucose and fructose. And of course, they are composed of carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen in the proportion of 1:2:1. And like I've said earlier on, the N there can be between 3 and 7. So you can have a monosaccharide, which is 3 carbon. Example is glyceraldehyde or dihydroxyacetone. We'll talk about that later. You can have another monosaccharide who has 7 carbons. An example is the molecule called pseudoheptulose. So the N can vary from 3 to 7. And we'll see later that this basic formula is an oversimplification, because it cannot tell the functional group and the placement of the OH, where we'll see later on that they are pretty important in determining the function of those carbohydrates. We also have to bear in mind that many of the intermediates of carbohydrate metabolism do also carry phosphate groups. So for example, DNA structure, deoxyribonucleic acid, the basic unit contains a sugar, which is deoxyribose, phosphorylated, and also attached to the base. So all these are modifications, and they have other functions apart from just being energy sources. With respect to naming, we can name monosaccharides based on the functional group present. And there are two functional groups that can be found in sugars. These are aldehyde and ketone. Aldehyde and ketone. So if a monosaccharide contains a ketone functional group, it is called a ketose. But if you contain an aldehyde functional group, you are called an aldose. And because sugars contain multiple OH groups, we can combine the number of OH and the functional group to name them. So you can have something like polyhydroxyaldehyde, which is an aldose, and a polyhydroxyketone, which becomes a ketose. So these two structures here demonstrate that if you look at this aldehyde functional group from basic organic chemistry, we know that it's a carbonyl carbon bonded to carbon and one hydrogen. So the C double bond O is the carbonyl, is bonded to one carbon, and there's hydrogen. So there's an aldehyde. So a sugar with this aldehyde functional group is called an aldose. If you look at the ketone functional group, it is a carbonyl bonded to two other carbons. So there's a carbonyl in the center of two carbons. So it becomes a ketone, and the sugar is called a ketose. Another way of naming sugars is based on the number of carbons they contain. So if I have 3-carbon monosaccharide, it becomes a triose. A 4-carbon becomes a tetrose. 5 becomes a pentose. A 6 becomes a hexose, and so on. So if I want to combine the aldehyde ketone naming with the number of carbons, then I can name a 4-carbon sugar with an aldehyde as an aldotetrose. So aldo referring to the aldehyde functional group, and then the tetrose referring to the 4 carbons it contains. In addition to these general names, each monosaccharide also has a unique name, and this is based on the different isomeric forms. And if you remember in senior high school, isomers are a group of compounds having the same empirical formula but having different structural formulae. So when we're talking about isomers, we know that there are different types, and here we are specifically referring to the optical isomers. That is isomers that are different on the basis of their relations with plain polarized light. So we can have, in this case, a D isomer, and we can have an IL isomer. The next slide will help us to differentiate between the two. So if I talk about glucose, it means that I can have a D glucose and an L glucose. So think about answers to this question. What do you think will be the name of a 6-carbon sugar that contains an aldehyde group and a 6-carbon sugar that contains a ketone functional group? Be thinking about that. So let's look at a few more examples. So I'm sure you can tell from here that this is an aldehyde functional group. There are 3 carbons, right? So based on the functional group, is an aldose. Based on the number of carbons, it's a triose. So putting the two names together, we will call it an aldotriose. But its correct name is D-glyceraldehyde, the D-glyceraldehyde. Then, if you look at the 6-carbon sugar, it has an aldehyde functional group. So it's an aldose, it's a hexose. Putting them together will be an aldohexose, but it's actually the structure of glucose. The last one demonstrated here is fructose. It has 6 carbons with a ketone functional group. So it is a ketose, it's an hexose, and you put the two together, it becomes a ketohexose. And that's actually the structure of D-fructose. When we meet in class, we are going to add additional detail so that you can all be able to draw the structure of glucose and fructose, and please pay particular attention to the position of the OH. Pay attention to the position of the OH on the straight chain carbons. Bear also in mind that sugars, usually as presented in straight chains, in biological systems exist as ring structures. So we can have the sugars as straight chains and also as ring structures. And the reaction is usually So when we meet in class, we are going to demonstrate that this formation of the cyclic structure is based on something we call internal cyclization, which can occur between the carbonyl carbon and the OH to the penultimate carbon. The penultimate carbon is the last but one carbon. And you see this internal cyclization demonstrated, and we all learn how to draw the ring structures of these sugars. So based on the ring structures, we are going to derive another name that will come with the use of two Greek letters, alpha and beta. So that when we have a structure like D-glucose, we will show how to get its ring structure, and we can derive two other names as alpha D-glucose or beta D-glucose. I will demonstrate this in class. The next class of carbohydrates are the disaccharides. So the word di means two, and saccharide I've mentioned is for general classification of carbohydrate. And this means that we have two sugars joined together. Now the bond that holds them is called a glycosidic bond, a glycosidic bond. So we are going to again demonstrate how this is obtained, but we can easily do this because it is a decondensation, or what you call a dehydration reaction, where water is removed between the two bonding units, and then a glycosidic is formed. Again, when we meet in class, we demonstrate how this happens. We can have another classification called oligosaccharides, which consists of 3 to 10 monosaccharide units, again joined by glycosidic bonds. And the largest group is polysaccharides, which can have large numbers of monosaccharides. A good example is starch, and starch is found in animals. So starch is the storage form of carbohydrates in plants. Glycogen is a storage form of carbohydrates in animals. And cellulose is actually the cell wall material of plant cell walls. Now let's talk about stereoisomers. And we talk about a few things. So the prefix D and L, as we've mentioned before, are what you call stereoisomers. And this is a member of a pair which must have the same molecular formula, the same type of bonding, but they only differ in the spatial arrangement, in the spatial arrangement of the individual molecules. So the branch of chemistry that does this is called stereochemistry. Now, bear in mind that if I look at, let's jump to this slide. If I look at these two molecules, this is a carbon with four different molecules around it. Bear in mind that a carbon with four different groups around is called chiral. The word is chiral, C-H-I-R-A-L. Now, if I put this molecule in front of a mirror, you will see that there is a change in positions of the molecules. So if you see this carbon, the B is to the right. But if you look at the mirror image, the B is to the left. They may be mirror images, but if you observe, they are not superimposable. That means that one will not fit directly on the other. Now, so in this example, we are saying that the carbon is called a chiral carbon, and the two stereoisomers are mirror images, but remember we said that they are not superimposable. So let's bring this to the carbohydrate structures. Now, let's first look at the structure of this three-carbon sugar called glyceraldehyde. If you observe it closely, the first carbon, which is the aldehyde functional group, has three groups attached to it. So this carbon is not chiral. So this will not exhibit chirality or difference in spatial arrangement with this carbon. If you look at carbon 2, we can see that the carbon 2 has four groups around it. The OH, the H, the CH2OH, and the CHO up here. If you look at this third carbon, you see that it has C and two H's, so they are not different groups. So for this three carbon sugar, the only carbon that will exhibit chirality is the second carbon. If you look at the glyceraldehyde, this one, the OH is to the left of the chiral carbon. Now we say that by convention, if you look at the chiral carbon and the OH is to the right, we call it a D sugar. But if the OH is to the left, refer to it as an L sugar. If you have more than 3 carbons being chiral, if you have more than, let me say, more than one carbon being chiral, then we look at the last but one carbon from the end. And here, the end is the opposite side of the carbonyl. So if the carbonyl is number one, then the last but one carbon in the carbon chain is where we look at in classifying either as a D or an L. I hope that is clear. And please, we will later on learn of another D and L, which you must not confuse because those mean a different thing. Next, we talk about rotation of plane polarized light. So one thing about stereoisomers is the ability to reflect plane polarized light in different directions. And when we talk about plane polarized light, we are talking about light which is transparent or moving in one plane or one wavelength, right? So if you take white light is made up of different colors, what you know as the colors of the rainbow. But if I can use a diffracting prism to separate the component of the light to get light through a silt that is just one plane, then we describe it as the plane polarized light. Now, this principle of polarization, plane polarized light, optical activity, and rotation is applied in an instrument in the biochemistry lab called a polarimeter. So what a polarimeter does is it generates the plane polarized light and interacts that light with the solution of the sugar of interest. So depending on the angle and direction of rotation, and because each sugar has a unique rotation pattern, we can use that to aid the qualitative identification of sugars. So the light can be rotated in the clockwise or in the anti or counterclockwise direction. So bear in mind, if it is rotated to the right, we call the sugar dextrorotatory, and we give the symbol plus or small d. Please don't confuse this small d with the capital D we talked about. That capital D shows that the OH is to the right on the most chiral or the penultimate or the last but one carbon. But this little small letter D or the plus means that in a polarimeter, the sugar rotates plane polarized light to the right. Opposite is also true. If it is rotated to the left or counterclockwise, then we say the sugar is level rotatory. And we give it a small symbol, negative or small L. And again, don't confuse the small L with the big L, where the big L is talking about the position of the OH to the left of the last but one carbon. So demonstrated here is the diagram or the schematic presentation of the polarimeter. So we have the source of light, we have the lens that will diffract and then make the light in different directions, and it goes into the polarimeter that will produce plane polarized light. This is our sample tube that usually contains a known concentration of the sugar. We measure the direction of rotation, and with the use of an observing lens, we can see the direction of rotation. So the rotation we measure is given the symbol alpha. The T means the temperature of measurement, and then the delta, the gamma here, is just telling us the wavelength of measurement. So if I measure the standard optical activity or standard rotation, then I'm talking about the angle of rotation, right, divided by a product of the concentration and the length of the sample tube. So usually the length is 1 centimeter. You can prepare a solution of 1 gram per centimeter, 1 gram per mil. And then measuring this, we can calculate the specific rotation. And values of specific rotation can be used to identify sugars. Remember in my previous discussion, I said that there are straight chains and ring chains of structures. So the straight chains are called Fischer projections. where we draw a straight chain carbon and we put the OHs and Hs around them. So we're going to demonstrate more of this in class. And this could be an example. We just draw straight charge. Sometimes you can even omit the carbons, but where two lines meet, it tells you that there is a carbon in between them. So we've discussed the D and L, the capital D and capital L. We've discussed the small e and small l. So we can put the names together, but please bear in mind that the D, the capitals are for the positions, and the small letters are for the rotation. So please don't confuse these two. So like I've demonstrated, this is a D sugar. Why? Because this OH is to the right. This is a D sugar because the OH is to the right. This is a D sugar because the OH is to the right. If I draw the same thing and I put this OH on the last but one carbon to the left, then all these sugars become L sugars. Friends, from this point to the end of the lecture, we're going to talk about biologically important molecules. So we're going to talk about biologically important monosaccharides, disaccharides, and polysaccharides. And then where we need to add more details, we look at, for example, disaccharides and polysaccharides. We look at the type of glycosidic linkage. We look at the orientation of the alpha and beta, and therefore their implication in health. So first, let's go monosaccharides, and we have mentioned that there are between 3 and 7 carbons. There are many of them, but in this lecture, I only talk about those which are of biological importance, and those include 5 and 6 carbons. So we'll begin with glucose. Glucose is the most important of all the sugars to the human body, and it has different names. It has different food sources. We can call it dextrose. We can call it grape sugar or blood sugar. And we normally break glucose down through the process called glycolysis. And the levels of glucose in the body is very critical for body function. And therefore, two hormones are used for regulation. And that includes insulin and glucagon. So when you have excess glucose, the body will produce insulin, which would enable the absorption of glucose for use by the cell or for storage. And when there are less glucose, the body will produce glucagon that usually act on the liver to break down the stored glycogen into the free glucose the body can use. The normal blood glucose level should be between 100 and 120 milligram per 100 ml. And the highest levels occur usually after meals. And the lowest level occurs usually after fasts. I think about 8 hours fast. That is when you have your basal metabolic levels of glucose. I've already spoken about insulin, which helps in the absorption of glucose. And I've also talked about glucagon, which helps in the release of glucose from the storage. In actual fact, remember I've said that sugars, we have drawn them in straight chains. But in actual fact, they exist in a cyclic form. So like we demonstrate in class, we see how the straight chains can be converted to ring structures, and we will demonstrate this later on. But as a brief to that, for aldehydes, there is an internal cyclization between the carbon 1, which has the aldehyde functional group, and the last but one OH, that is a D or the LOH, and that will form. There's this internal cyclization, and that will form what is called a hemiacetal. So after forming the ring structures, I've told you there can be the alpha and beta forms depending on the arrangement, which we will demonstrate in class. So after you get the alpha and beta, it is alpha when the OH is to the top and is to the bottom, and it is beta when the OH is to the top. And once we do that, we call those pairs anomers. We call those pairs anomers. And I must also hint to you that if you take two sugars and they are different only with respect to the position of the OH on one of the carbons, they are described as epimers. So we are going to demonstrate some of these things during the lecture. So like we demonstrate in class, just see this example so that you have an idea of how this is done before we meet for the lecture. So this is D-glucose. This is an open chain or a straight chain. Now, I said that the reaction is between the carbon 1 and the carbon, last but one carbon, carbon 5. So see how I begin the cyclization. So the carbon 1 is now here, the carbon 5 is here, and the 6 is attached to 5. So the internal cyclization should be between this OH and the H. So we put this OH and the H And this OH here now becomes, this O here becomes an OH, and this will join that. And then the one of the carbon oxygens will close the ring. So this is carbon 1, right? This is the O that was initially OH here. So this has joined the two carbon 1 and carbon 5 together. Then don't forget that carbon 1 originally didn't have an OH. Now carbon 1 has an OH. So if the OH is to the bottom of the ring, like we've done here, it's an alpha. If the OH is to the top, it's a beta. Now, after generating the ring, the position of the OH on the respective carbons depend on the position of the OH on the straight chain. Bear that in mind. Depends on the position on the straight chain. So, if an OH is to the right on the straight chain, it's given a downward projection. If the OH is to the right of the straight chain, it's given a downward projection. And if it's to the left, it's given an upward projection. So, if you look at carbon 3, carbon 3 is here. The OH on the straight chain was to the left. If you come to the ring, it's given an upward projection. If you look at carbon 4, OH was to the right, is given a downward projection. Carbon 6 is given an upward projection by default, because in chemistry, if you put this ring, this structure within the ring, it causes what we call steric hindrance, and that can cause the stability of the ring structure. The same thing is done for the beta form, but the only difference is that the OH on the anomeric carbon, that is that carbon which originally was not a chiral, which originally was not chiral, but has become chiral with the cyclization, will determine the alpha and beta. So if it is up, it's beta. If it is down, it is alpha. So please bear in mind that the same thing will apply for all other hexoses. All other hexoses. So 6-carbon hexos, an aldehyde will give a 6-membered ring. A 5-carbon aldehyde will also give a 5-membered ring. But when we discuss fructose, you observe that that is slightly different. So the next sugar of importance is fructose, also called levulose or fruit sugar. It's the sweetest of all sugars, and largest amount can be found in honey, corn syrup, and sweet fruits. It has the same molecular formula as glucose, but the only difference is that fructose is a ketose. Let's bear that in mind. Again, fructose can also have the L form or the D form, and it can go undergo the internal cyclization as we've discussed for aldehyde, that is glucose. But at this time, the bond will be between the ketone functional group on carbon 2 and the last but one carbon on carbon 5. So instead of having a 6-membered ring, you're rather going to have a 5-membered ring. And this type of reaction is called a hemiketal reaction. So like we've demonstrated before, the cyclization is between carbon 2 and carbon 5, and you get 5-membered ring. And again, the alpha OH is down, the beta OH is up. The up and down OH on carbon 3 and 4 is the same convention we discussed in aldehyde. So if you are carbon with the OH to the right, you are given a downward projection. If you have OH to the left, you are given an upward projection. Another glucose, another monosaccharide of importance is galactose, and it's also called milk sugar. So galactose is an epimer of glucose. Remember, I've defined what an epimer is. An epimer is a molecule different from each other, or two monosaccharides with respect to only one carbon. So if you look at the structure of glucose and that of galactose, you observe that they are only different with respect to carbon 4. So if you look at carbon 4 of glucose, OH was to the right, but for galactose, OH is to the left. And again, when we form the ring structures, we can get an alpha or a beta D galactose. Galactose is called, like I've mentioned, milk sugar. It's a principal sugar found in milk. And a modification of galactose called the beta DM acetyl galactose amine is a component of blood group antigens. So it's going to have the same structure of galactose, but you see here, there's an amino group which has been acetylated. So this is called beta, because the OH is up here, N acetyl galactose amine, a component of blood sugar, I mean blood glucose, blood antigens. Two other sugars of importance are 5-carbon. We are talking about ribose, which is a component of RNA and some coenzymes, and deoxyribose, a component of DNA. So ribose has 5-carbon sugar. It's an aldehyde. It will undergo internal cyclization between carbon 5 and carbon 4, and it will form two rings, either as the alpha or the beta D-glucose. DNA, on the other hand, contains a 2-deoxyribose. It's deoxy because the position 2 of the ribose has lost its oxygen. So it's a 2-deoxyribose, and we all know that it's a component of DNA, which is a store of genetic information. Let's just talk about the important disaccharides. And please, for the disaccharides, there are two things you have to observe for each. One is the type of monosaccharides present, and two is the orientation of the glycosidic bond. Now, the orientation of the glycosidic bond is dependent on the orientation of the anomeric carbons. And please, don't forget what anomeric carbons are. They are the carbons which were not chiral in the straight chain, but has become chiral in the ring structure. So depending on the orientation, whether it's an alpha or a beta, and the bond is either between carbon 1 and carbon 3 or 4 or 5 or 6, will determine the name of the disaccharide. So we begin with maltose. So maltose is a disaccharide of 2 glucose units. And like I did mention, look out for the units and also the nature of the orientation. So I'll jump to this diagram and show you maltose. So this is maltose, and the linkage is between an alpha D and a beta or an alpha D glucose. So this first glucose is alpha, but the second glucose can be alpha or beta. And look at the carbon one of the first glucose, it's in the alpha position. So the glycosidic will be between the carbon one of the first sugar and carbon 4 of the second sugar. So the bond will be called an alpha 1-4. So you see the alpha 1 between carbon 1 and between carbon 4. But if I want to name this maltose, I'll call it a beta maltose. Why? Because the anomeric carbon of the second sugar is in the beta position, meaning that I can derive an alpha maltose, where the anomeric carbon will be in the alpha position in the second sugar. So maltose is produced from the hydrolysis of starch, and like I did say, the bond holding them is called a glycosidic bond. And we also call maltose a reducing sugar. Why? Because the anomeric carbon of the second sugar is free. So bear in mind that to be described as a reducing sugar, you should have a free anomeric carbon, and maltose has a free anomeric carbon. Next, we talk about lactose. So lactose is a disaccharide of beta D galactose and either alpha or beta D glucose. So the first sugar is always a beta D galactose, and I've mentioned that galactose is an epimer of glucose with respect to carbon 4. And therefore, in the cyclic, we've talked about all this already. So let's see the structure of galactose. So galactose, remember, I said is between beta D galactose and alpha or beta D glucose. So the glycosidic linkage is going to be a beta 1-4. Why? Because the galactose is in the beta orientation. That's why the OH is up. The carbon 4 OH of the, in this case, beta D galactose is not down. So look at how the orientation of the beta 1-4 linkage will be. So I'm going to call this a beta galactose, a beta lactose, please, because the anomeric carbon of the glucose is upwards. Now, in humans, we suffer from a genetic disease called galactosemia, which is due to the absence of the enzyme that breaks lactose, that can convert lactose to glucose. The body cannot metabolize galactose, it can metabolize glucose. So once you have glucose, there's an enzyme called an epimerase that must convert the galactose into glucose. Without the enzyme, the galactose will accumulate and will become toxic in those higher concentrations, and it can lead to mental retardation, cataract in babies and children, and even in adults, and it can even lead to early death in children. Now, the cataract is because the galactose can be converted to the alcohol form called galactitol. Galactitol, and this can accumulate in the lens of the eye and lead to the cataract. So the only way we can treat this condition is to give such people milk which is devoid of lactose or devoid of galactose. So you go to the market, you see lactose free milk, and that is because of this condition called galactosemia. Also in adults and some children, they are unable to break down the lactose to produce glucose and galactose. So in this case, the lactose will accumulate. The enzyme defect is called lactase, and the condition is called lactose intolerance. So the undigested lactose will remain in the intestinal tract. It can cause cramps and diarrhea. And sometimes it can even accumulate, and microorganisms will act on it, producing carbon dioxide. That can lead to bloating and also the release of gases, which can be unpleasant. And the only way we can do this is to avoid milk at all. So if you drink milk and you seem to have stomach cramps, pain in the lower abdomen, you seem to fluctuate a lot, it could be a possibility of you suffering from lactose intolerance. The next disaccharide is sucrose, also called table sugar. It is water soluble. It can be transported through the circulatory system of plants, and it cannot be synthesized by animals. Indeed, the transport form of carbohydrates in plants is sucrose. High concentration can also have been shown to induce high osmotic pressure, and this can be used as a basis for food preservation. And it be suggested that usually diets which are high in sucrose are described as empty calories, because they lack vitamins and minerals. There has also been shown to be a negative correlation between excessive intake of sucrose and dentary and dental caries or cavities. So remember, as children, if you were eating a lot of toffees, it comes with a lot of caries or decays in your tooth. Sucrose is a disaccharide of two monosaccharides, that is alpha D glucose and beta D fructose. Alpha D glucose and beta D glucose. But in sucrose, the difference is that the glycosidic bond is formed between the two anomeric carbons, the alpha of the glucose, the beta of the fructose. So the linkage will be called alpha 1 beta 2 glycosidic bond. Alpha 1 beta 2 glycosidic bond. And because both anomeric carbons are involved in the glycosidic linkage, sucrose has been described as a non-reducing sugar. You are reducing sugar when you have a free anomeric carbon, but you become a non-reducing sugar when both anomeric carbons are involved in the glycosidic bond linkage. So bear that in mind. Next, we proceed to talk about the polysaccharides, again, of biological importance. So we begin with our good friend starch. So it's the most abundant carbohydrate. Plants have the ability through photosynthesis to use sunlight energy, carbon dioxide, and water to produce the smaller unit glucose, and the glucose can then be pieced together to form starch, which is the storage form of glucose in plants. And these are usually stored in starch granules within the cell. Nearly all plant cell contains some starch granules, but bear in mind, some have more. So for example, seeds like corn can have as much as 80% of the cell dry matter being starch. Again, starch is known to be heterogeneous of two materials which are both polymers of glucose, and that is amylose and amylopectin. Amylose is usually the straight chain one. It's about 20% of starch in all plant cells. It is linear, so I said it's a straight chain, and it contains only alpha-D glucose chains. Only alpha-D glucose chains. And the interaction or the glycosidic bond is alpha-1-4, right? If I take a single chain of amylose, it can contain up to 4,000 glucose units and usually coils and have some intramolecular hydrogen bonds in these molecules. So this is what we are talking about in amylose, straight chain with alpha-1 linkages throughout the molecule. In digestion, if I want to break down amylose, then it's broken down by two enzymes, beginning from the mouth. So the mouth will have salivary amylase, and then the digestion will be completed in the stomach, where it is mixed with pancreatic amylase, and that will complete the process of digestion. So what the amylase does is it cleaves a glycosidic bond at random manner and puts into pieces, specifically two carbon units called maltose. Then a second enzyme called maltase will complete the digestion. Now the glucose that is produced is then quickly absorbed, and you know that it becomes an energy source for the body. Amylopectin, on the other hand, is highly branched and contains additional alpha-1-6 linkages at the branch point. So amylose is straight chain with alpha-1-4, but amylopectin has both alpha-1-4 and alpha-1-6 glycosidic linkage. And the branches usually occur between 20 to 25 glucose units. So this is amylose straight chain, but look at amylopectin with some branching, and at the branch point, we have the alpha-1-6 linkage. So it becomes more polymorphic, more branched, more compact than the straight chain ones. Glycogen is a major store of glucose in animals, and the structure of glycogen is very similar to amylopectin. So glycogen also has alpha-1-4 and alpha-1-6 linkages. The difference here is that in glycogen, the branch points are more often. So there are more branches in glycogen than there are in amylopectin. Otherwise, these two molecules are virtually the same. In humans, we store most of our glycogen in the liver and in the skeletal muscle. The difference is that for the ones in the liver, it's supposed to maintain glucose level. Remember we said glucose level have to always be maintained at constant level. So if the level of glucose in circulation is low, the body would depend on what is stored in the liver to replenish it. But the glycogens of the muscle are for muscle activity. And of course, you know that once your muscles are continuously contracting and relaxing, we need a constant source of energy. And that comes from the glycogen we store in the muscle. So to compare, this is glycogen, and you can see a lot more branching than we saw in amylopectin. And it's this branching. The science is that the more the branching, the more easier it is when you want to mobilize the glucose for cellular activity. There are several branch points from which you can break down the glucose and release them into circulation. The final polysaccharide I want to talk about is cellulose, which we know as the plant cell material. It's the most abundant polysaccharide, and it contains only beta-D-glucose. Please get a difference. Alpha-D-glucose is found in starch, the two types, amylose and amylopectin, and glycogen. But cellulose contains beta-D-glucose, and therefore the glycosidic interaction in cellulose will be beta-1-4. Bear that in mind. Will be beta-1-4 and not alpha-1-4. A typical cellulose can contain up to 3,000 glucose units, but there can be others that can contain up to 26,000, like the algae called valonia, contains up to 26,000 units of glucose. Now, cellulose is a very important structural component in plant cell wall, and it usually forms what you call fibrils, and this is associated with the intermolecular hydrogen bond. So if I have two chains of cellulose, they lie side by side, and the OH of one can interact with the OH of the other through hydrogen bonding, and that contributes to the stability of cellulose as a cell wall material, and therefore it's able to resist the turgidity that comes with accumulation of water in plant cells. So these fibrils are quite rigid and held together by hydrogen bonds. I've mentioned that. And compare that to the amylose, amylopectin, and glycogen. Cellulose cannot be digested by humans because we lack the enzyme called cellulase that's supposed to digest it. But if you go to a group of animals we know as ruminants, they harbor some microorganisms in their gut as well as that of termites. And these microorganisms are able to break down cellulose to remove or to yield the glucose, which the body can make use in energy production. So this is a structure of cellulose. So what we have done up to this point is to look at the basic chemistry of carbohydrates. We talked about the monosaccharides and how we name them according to number of carbons and according to the two functional groups present, either a ketone or an aldehyde functional group. We also looked at structures of them. So we're going to draw some in class or in lecture. So we look at the straight chain as well as the ring structures. We've talked about disaccharides of importance. We've talked about monosaccharides of importance. And we've ended with these polysaccharides, which are of biological importance. Thank you.